السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والسماء ذات البروج واليوم الموعود وشاهد ومشهود قتل أصحاب الأخدود قتل أصحاب الأخدود النار ذات الوقود إذ هم عليها قعود وهم على ما يفعلون بالمؤمنين شهود وما نقموا منهم إلا أن يؤمنوا بالله العزيز الحميد الذي له ملك السماوات والأرض والله على كل شيء شهيد إن الذين فتنوا المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثم لم يتوبوا ولهم عذاب جهنم ولهم عذاب الحريق إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم جنات تجري من تحتها الأنهار ذلك الفوز الكبير ان آيات کا ترجمہ یہ ہے
The translation of these verses is by the heaven having mentions of stars and by the promised day and by the witness and that about whom witness has been born. Cursed be the fellows of the trench, the fire fed with fuel, as they sat by it, and they witnessed what they did to the believers. And they hated them not, but because they believed in Allah the Almighty, the Praiseworthy. To whom belongs the kingdom of the heavens and the earth, and Allah is witness over all things. Those who persecute the believing men and the believing women, and then repent not, for them is surely the punishment of hell, and for them is the punishment of burning. But those who believe and do good works, for them are gardens through which streams flow. That is the great triumph. The verses that I have recited precisely depict and illustrate the incident that occurred against the Ahmadis in Gujranwala. This is such an argument in support of the truthfulness of Ahmadiyyat and the promised Messiah on whom be peace, that if fair-minded Muslims reflect upon Suratul Buruj, then the reality would be exposed of the persecution, cruelty and wrongdoing that is perpetrated in the attitude and actions of the scholars, the leaders and the governments, which is shown by the opponents of Ahmadiyyat. They would come to believe in the truthfulness of the promised Messiah on whom be peace. They would desist from the wrongdoing and injustice that the oppressive people and their followers commit against Ahmadis. However, to understand the word of God also requires one who has been sent by God. The state of such people, however, is that they do not want to lend an ear at all to him, and thus they continue in their cruel and oppressive ways. Here I will give a brief explanation of these verses. The mansions of the heavens that has been sworn by here means the 12 mansions of stars in the physical heavens, as has been expounded by astronomers. This is an allegorical reference to the spiritual mansions or bastions, which have an important connection with the history of Islam. And this infers the 12 divine reformers, or mujaddideens, who will keep the light burning in the spiritual firmament of Islam after the sun had set. Those mujaddideens who gave light for some period of time. Regarding this period of time, there are ahadith and also the statements of the previous scholars which support this. It is astonishing that Muslims do accept that in the history of Islam during its period of spiritual darkness, that Allah had sent 12 of His chosen ones over 12 centuries to spread the rays of light. Yet, when Allah has said, وَالْيَوْمِ الْمَوْءُودِ, that and by the promised day, and that in accordance with this promise, when God in the 13th century sent His promised one, they chose to reject Him. All the Holy Prophet ﷺ informed us regarding the earlier ones that reformers would appear at the head of every century. But Allah the Almighty has separately referred to this promised reformer. The Holy Prophet Muhammad ﷺ also informed us of various signs such as the solar and lunar eclipses, as well as countless other signs, with reference to this promised reformer, which have and continue to be fulfilled as bright as day. So the signs have been foretold about this promised reformer who would appear, yet they reject him. In fact, after the claim of the promised Messiah on whom be peace, some began to assert, and even today it is said quite fervently, that they now stand in no need for any reformer. And this is because the Maulvis and the so-called scholars would have their seats of authority and their pulpits removed from them. And this is also because their intellect and knowledge would be exposed. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, on whom be peace, says, with reference to his coming in this era, in exact accordance with the prophecies, that it is an astounding matter, which I consider as a sign of Allah the Almighty, that precisely in 1290 Hijri, this humble one was honored with a communication from God the Almighty. A short duration later, he also made his claim to be the promised Messiah. Heavenly and earthly signs were fulfilled in his favor. Details of this is found in the literature of the Jamaat as well as in the writings of the promised Messiah on whom be peace. I do not intend at this time to go into the details of this, but nonetheless, most certainly the help and succor of God the Almighty bears witness that this is the era of the promised Messiah. Then Allah the Almighty says that at the time of this promised day, that is the time of the promised Messiah, undoubtedly the renaissance of Islam will be witnessed, and the period of the rejuvenation of Islam will definitely commence. But the mu'mins, the believers, those who will accept the promised Messiah, will have to render great sacrifices. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, says, قُتِلَ أَصْحَابُ الْأُخْدُورِ, that cursed be the fellows of the trench. النَّارِ ذَاتِ الْوَقُودِ, the fire fed with fuel. إِذْهُمْ عَلَيْهَا قُعُودِ, as they sat by it. This depicts an illustration of the opponents and enemies, and describes the fact that opposition of this type will be faced. But the fires of persecution that will be kindled, that they will sit around, will most certainly be faced. However, the enemies will reach their sorry fate. The mu'mins, the believers, will have to endure a long period of oppression, tyranny, and horrific persecution. The promised Messiah, alayhi salam, has also drawn attention towards this point, that the progress of Islam also requires certain sacrifices of us, and that requirement is of death. This is what is being inferred in these verses, that fire fed with great amounts of fuel will be kindled against you. Fuel will constantly be added to this fire. Those who will kindle this fire will be sitting around watching the entire spectacle unfold. Such people who will make these plans according to their own understanding will be as if they have dug trenches, restricting the movement of the believers, surrounding them from all sides, and will then light their fires. Allah the Almighty, however, has said already that indeed you may have to suffer and endure passing through fire. But ultimately, these people who will endeavor to surround the believers from all sides in fire will be destroyed themselves. In their own presumptions, they will try to encircle the believers in fire, considering that they will not allow them to survive. Thus, we observe how the police was standing by watching the entire spectacle and does not try to save the people, but rather participates in the kindling of the fire. Furthermore, all those who kindle the fire do not only stand by watching, but rather they actually take delight in burning the believers. Izhum alayha qu'ud. Indeed, this does not refer to any past incident, but this is actually a prophecy which hints to us the nature of the fire that will be kindled by the enemies against us. And it indicates that these people will actually stand guard after they kindle the fire. This is further proof of the fact that we are on the right path and are believers, mu'mins. And of the fact that those enemies are in the category of those who kindle fire against the believers. Furthermore, it is not only that they encircle the believers in fire to prevent them from escaping from it. Indeed, they take joy and delight in the burning of the believers. I'll present some details with reference to the martyrs, from which you will clearly see that exactly in accordance with this, that they kindled a fire and trapped them in the room. The approximately dozen or so people who they had trapped in the room, they then threw the windows, taunting them by waving their hands and raising slogans, and then fled. So they did this to tauntingly inform them that they are now trapped and that there was no way they could now escape. In the video of this incident, it is evident from the faces of these cruel people that they are displaying shamelessness to the extreme through their actions and their slogans and what they were saying. In any case, this is their extreme enmity. In fact, just a few days after this incident, near to that same vicinity, a Maulvi gathered people together and took an oath from them that nothing really was done to the Ahmadis of this area. So you promise me that we will act to an even greater degree than this and that you will support me. So thus, this is not an incident after which we can say that perhaps as a result of martyring innocent women and children that they would feel shame. There are such shameless people who think in such a manner. Where on Twitter, where messages are tweeted on the phone, are sending messages expressing their views that it was really good what happened with the Ahmadis and this is what should occur. Inna lillah. And what is most saddening is that all of this is happening in the name of Allah and His Messenger. Izhum alayha qu'ud. This also makes it evident that they will remain seated permanently. They will try to lengthen their schemes to inflict the plans, to inflict punishment and torture. Qu'ud means to remain seated. And to remain seated is a metaphorical description or allegory to depict something that is done for a long period of time. So their period of lying, fabrication, deceit and inflicting persecution is continuing. And perhaps it will remain for a long period of time because the opposition continues. These people will continue in these schemes. But there is always an end to this. And that end is what Allah has decreed for them, that they will also continuously be burnt. Ultimately, what will happen? That they will be destroyed by this very fire and will be placed in it. Their scholars know well that they falsify things. They possess no arguments through which they can rebut the claim of the promised Messiah on whom be peace, except for fabrications or twisting the literature and statements and incidents from the books of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. Enmity has blinded them, and they are continuing and will continue in these ways. In the kindling of the fire, they are also taking along the people at large with them. So at times they kindle these fires literally and physically to try and burn the believers. And in some way or the other, they are successful in these attempts, whereas in other places they fail. And at times, but actually permanently, there is the fire of opposition to Ahmadiyyat, which they constantly try to kindle in all directions. In every city and every street and alleyway in Pakistan today, anti-Ahmadiyya literature, which are based on complete falsehood, are posted everywhere. This is even found in government buildings, to the extent that it is found posted in the High Court. There are such erroneous notions attributed to the promised Messiah or to the doctrines and beliefs of the Jamaat, which knows no bounds. They associate these things with the Jamaat and thereby incite people against us. Such wrong concepts are attributed to the Jamaat, which have no link with us whatsoever. It is as a result of such opposition that the promised Messiah reassures the Jamaat and says, "Do not ever think that Allah will let you go to waste. You are a seed sown by the hand of God in the ground. Allah says that this seed will flourish, will grow, and its branches will spread in all directions and will form a large tree. So blessed be he who holds firm faith in the words of God and who does not fear the trials and tribulation that will appear in between." So thus, most certainly, we'll go on having to give sacrifices. But this tree of the Jamaat that has been planted by God the Almighty, with the grace of God, will continue to grow and flourish. Those who kindle the fire will see themselves burn in the very fire that they kindle. Or through some other way, God the Almighty will bring about the means for their destruction and ruin. Qutila ashabul ukhdud, cursed be the fellows of the trench. This is a prophecy which is and will continue to be fulfilled in support of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat. These people will go on being destroyed and ruined. And therefore, this prophecy will also come to be fulfilled upon these cruel people. It is not that they will desist from their oppressive ways. In fact, they will constantly repeat them. But the tree of Ahmadiyyat, which was planted by God Himself, will go on growing and flourishing. The 125-year history of the Jamaat and the progress that we experience should have been a lesson for them to learn that this is no human endeavor. Rather, this is the work of God. When one interferes with the work of God and attempts to halt it, then all it will do is incur the anger of God and nothing else. They are aware that they act in the wrong way, that the Holy Quran does not support them, and nor does any statement of the Messenger of God. I related various incidents of the companions of the promised Messiah on whom be peace. In that, and now, also those people who accept the truth and enter into the fold of the community and do the bet, I have related within such incidents. That the so-called scholars assert that do not speak to the Qadianis based on the Quran. These ulama, these Muslim scholars, have blindfolded these people and try to teach them to not speak to them on the basis of the Holy Quran. For if you do, they will prove to you the death of Jesus. They will prove their definition of Khatamun Nabiyyin, and they will also prove the truthfulness of the promised Messiah. In fact, now they even say that neither speak to them at all nor listen to anything they say. And they do so because they are fully aware that they have no arguments or reasons. Indeed, they have stubbornness in their views, through which they may try to present the self-concocted interpretations through wrong teachings and concepts. They have fooled the public at large. And in this understanding, they perpetrate this cruelty and make others do so by asserting that the majority support them. The state of the media and TV channels is such that recently there was a Maulvi Sahib who, without naming the Ahmadis, was on his own part, he was trying to pacify the people by saying that this should not have happened in this manner. However, his emphasis was more on the statement that the minority should be mindful of the sentiments of the majority. Now they themselves are the ones who kill. They place their own allegations, they become the judges themselves, and place verdicts themselves, and then administer punishment themselves. In any case, because they have street power and also the religious authority, and that the politicians believe that they have to oppose the Ahmadis for their politics. This is why the government also fully supports these Maulvis. But they are unaware of the fate that Allah has decreed for them. Allah the Almighty says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ فَتَنُوا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَتُوبُوا فَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمَ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْحَرِيقِ. Those who persecute the believing men and the believing women and then repent not, for them is surely the punishment of hell, and for them is the punishment of burning. Allah the Almighty says that most certainly those who attempt to persecute the believing men and the believing women, who kindle fires against them and then place guards upon them, lest anyone come to save them. For them, the punishment of the hell is decreed. These people kindle physical fire, and also the concealed fire, so that people can try to persecute the believers in every way possible and continue to do so. Today, this disorder and also this concealed fire is kindled by these people saying that, God forbid, we Ahmadis do not accept the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We do not believe that he is the final prophet, or they assert that we insult and disgrace the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is an allegation that inflicts deep pain and suffering upon our hearts. whereas for the respect and honor and majesty and glory of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, the Ahmadis are fully engaged day and night all over the world. Wherever the Holy Prophet ﷺ's honor is attacked, it is Ahmadis who first of all stand up there to respond. So we are those who can accept our own death, but we cannot accept even the smallest amount of defamation of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is precisely the teaching given to us by the promised Messiah, on whom be peace. Allah knows better our practices, as He knows well what is in our heart. He is aware that there is no contradiction or disparity. Otherwise, why would He continue to give progress to a false community despite the opposition of the entire world? For God knows that this is His community and He is going to make it progress. So thus Allah the Almighty has said, "Those who work day and night to establish His glory, majesty and His tawheed, His oneness, and to uphold the honor and dignity of His last messenger. Those who cause disorder and inflict harm to such people, who burn them or who burn their homes, or who attribute false things towards them and thus burn their hearts, God says He will not give such people respite. Rather, God says most certainly, I will throw them in the hellfire, unless they repent." God does accept tawbah, repentance, and forgives. But if they do not repent, then God says, remember, فَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمَ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْحَرِيقِ. Just as they burnt the homes and the hearts of the believers, or burnt them themselves, or make schemes to this effect, where sometimes they succeed, or sometimes they fail, in the same way they will be given punishment. But the people who commit this cruelty will be punished in two ways. It will be both physical and also internal. It will be the punishment of burning themselves, and also the punishment of the hellfire. By attributing false allegation towards us and associating fabrications towards that person who we love more than our lives, they try to burn our hearts. However, these people themselves are burning in the fire of jealousy, seeing the truth, and they question why the Jamaat is progressing so much. They ask why, despite so much opposition on their part, every individual of the Jamaat is firm on their faith. Why every single person of their Jamaat, men, women, elders and youth, do not fear them, and how they are able to confront and stand up face to face with the persecution that they mete out to them. The Ahmadis of Gujranwala gave great sacrifices in the disorder of 1974, and they set an example. Today also they have established new examples of sacrifices, in which a 7-month-old girl, an 8-year-old girl, and a woman gave the sacrifices of their lives, and thus they all established this example. In fact, an unborn who had not yet come into this world and was due to come into this world in just 2 or 3 months was also deprived of entering into this world through these cruel people and thus gave the sacrifice. In any case, God the Almighty has informed us about these wrongdoing people who kindle fires regarding what their fate will be. Alongside this, God the Almighty has also informed those who have faith regarding the reward they will achieve in recompense of these sacrifices. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْحَارِ ذَلِكُ الْفَوْزُ الْكَبِيرُ. But those who believe and do good works, for them are gardens through which streams flow. That is the great triumph. the enemy began this sequence of setting fires, and they watched over it to ensure that it never extinguished, as is mentioned in various reports, that they even stopped the fire brigade and started pelting it with stones so they could not advance to extinguish the fire. Similarly, the ambulance were prevented from reaching the wounded, and they stood in front of it and started dancing. Allah the Almighty says that for these victims, I have prepared such a paradise where there are gardens, where the branches are joined with one another. There are cool shades, underneath which streams flow. They can drink water and refresh their throats and their bodies whenever they wish. The enemy tried to give them intense heat of fire, but in paradise they will be given cool shades. Even the intense heat of the sun will not affect them there. The enemy tried to choke our innocent children and an unwell woman with smoke, or tried to make it dry by depriving them of water, so that they would die as a result of choking. But Allah the Almighty says that He will grant them an open and cool atmosphere and water, wherein their throats and bodies will always remain fresh. So thus, this is the clear-cut difference between those who will ignite fires and those who are the victims and the believers. To help against this cruelty, as before, we submit it to God, we do so today also. These verses also provide the answer to a question asked by a lady just recently from Germany after this incident. She said that there is a revelation of the promised Messiah alayhi salam that threatened me not with fire, for fire is my servant and indeed the servant of my servants. So the woman writing this letter did not say anything further. But the connotation appeared to be that he was asking why had all of this occurred. First of all, keep your faith strong. Allah the Almighty had informed us beforehand that such events would occur, as I explained in the commentary of these verses. These verses are very clear about this. The revelation also carries the meaning that we are not afraid of this. Just as the Holy Quran says, these people will ignite fires. This will definitely occur. But they will not be able to achieve the objective behind kindling these fire. The purpose, indeed, is to light these fires and lead Ahmadis astray from Ahmadiyyat. Their purpose is to try and frighten Ahmadis through the fire. But the question is the faith of a true believer ever wasted because of such actions? No, it has never been the case. Indeed, what has happened is that these fires have been subjugated themselves and shown true believers the path of progress. It has increased and strengthened their faith. If there has been physical and apparent loss sustained due to these fires, that too has worked as a fertilizer and has opened amazing new avenues of progress and introductions to the Jamaat. And many a times it has happened that the enemy has failed in their actions, as I have said. So thus, when every single outcome indicates divine help and succor, then it means that everything has different aspects and angles, both latent and hidden and concealed. As God the Almighty says, that He will give the punishment of fire and of hell to those who ignite and fuel these fires. But for the true believers who suffer loss due to these fires will be cool and shady paradise. The innocent children who gave their lives belong to paradise in any case. But this sacrifice has indeed made them even more dear to God. God has taken them in His loving embrace. It has not been said in the revelation of the promised Messiah that the fire is a sign for Ahmadis, or that it is a chastisement for others, or that we will be safeguarded from the fire. Such a sign has not been informed. The purpose was that we are not those who are afraid of fire. Indeed, this is sometimes fulfilled physically, and at times it is in an allegorical form. Sometimes fires are extinguished, and at other times loss is suffered. We observe that in the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, the torment and punishment destined for the infidels was the torment of war, and they were destroyed through it. No other punishment was meted out to them. This is what the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, has said, that this was the punishment decreed for them, and through this they were destroyed, and their power and might was broken. However, were Muslims not also martyred in these wars? Indeed, they were. Yet, while God deemed the death of the infidels as hellbound, there it was stated about the death of the Muslims that do not consider them as dead, for they are living. In the sight of God, they remain alive, and on a daily basis they are given beneficence of new provisions by God. So thus our martyrs also are in God's paradise. And perhaps this is the first time in the history of Ahmadiyyat that all those who have given this sacrifice are girls and women. There was no man involved in this sacrifice. The sacrifice of these innocent people is drawing them nearer to paradise. Inshallah, this will never go to waste or be fruitless. Here I should also clear that they lost their lives due to smoke inhalation, and no one was injured by the fire, although the perpetrators continuously burnt what they did not wish to loot, including household furniture, broken objects, other amenities, etc., and they used all of this as means of fuel. All the remaining inventory they looted. They constantly used all of these objects to fuel the fire. I will now present some of the details from the report regarding this incident. Those who were martyred included Bushra Begum Sahiba, the woman who was martyred, the wife of late Munir Ahmed Sahib. The girls were Hira Tabassum and Kainat Tabassum, the daughters of Muhammad Bhuta Sahib. Although everyone would have heard this incident, it has been reported widely, but I should still relate it briefly. On 27th July 2014, extremist opponents of Ahmadiyyat attacked and set fire to Ahmadi's home in Kachi Pump, Arafat Colony, Gujranwala, which resulted in the martyrdoms of 55-year-old Bushra Begum Sahiba, wife of the late Munir Ahmed Sahib, and two young children, 6-year-old Hira Tabassum and 8-month-old Kainat Tabassum. who were the daughters of Muhammad Bhutta Sahib, as I have said. They were all martyred. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Surely to Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. The report is that on the day of the attack, one of the sons of the deceased lady, Muhammad Ahmad Sahib, went to a nearby clinic after iftari to obtain medicine. There he saw his paternal cousin Waqas Ahmad being held by some people. When he asked what the matter was, they also started using abusive language against him and alleged that an Ahmadi youth had, God forbid, affronted a photograph of the Khana Kaaba on Facebook. They were then told that Ahmadis could never ever think about doing such a thing. From this, it was clear that this was a pre-planned, thought-out scheme. In any case, the enemies quickly resorted to beating up and started breaking glass bottles and using them. Seeing the critical state of the situation, Muhammad Ahmad immediately phoned his brother, Muhammad Bhutta Khan, and Uncle Fazal Ahmad from their shop and asked them to come over immediately. So he came to try and resolve the matter. During this time, Khalil Ahmad was injured through a broken bottle, but temporarily the matter ended and they returned home. He dropped his brother at home and went to the service station where his shop was located. Just a short while later, the doctor in front of whose clinic the incident had taken place rang Muhammad Bhutta and informed him that people were gathering in the form of a rally or procession and seemed to be preparing to attack their home. Similarly, the organization of traders also announced that people should shut their shops and gather, and whoever did not close his shop would do so at their own peril. So thus, this was proper planning that took place, and through a thought-out scheme. In this area, at very close proximity, there are 18 Ahmadi family homes in close-by streets and alleyways. When they heard of the trouble, 15 families evacuated their homes. However, the families of Muhammad Bhutta, Fazal Ahmad and two other families, that of Muhammad Ashraf Sahib Sadr Jamaat and his brother's family, were at home. About 8:30 p.m., the opponents attacked and started raising extremist slogans and also started firing. They started breaking down the front doors of the house, which were closed. Now, regarding this, the police had given wrong reports to the media that firing was carried out from both sides, whereas the firing was only carried out by the opponents of the Jamaat and not by anyone from the Jamaat. According to their plan, they started attacking simultaneously from all directions. There are many Shia residents of that area. And although normally Shias say many things, there they supported the attackers and were quite heavily involved. When the incident took place, the Sadr Jamaat immediately informed the SHO, the People's Colony, the station house officer of the police. He responded that he was on site with the police and was going to take the attackers for negotiations. Whereas the fact is, he did not do so. During this time, the extremists attacked one more time. They were armed with firearms and hammers to break down the doors and the walls. They were fully equipped with all sorts of weapons. A large crowd also gathered with them. They first of all broke off the electric meters and cut off the cables. Due to the severity of the situation, Sadr Sahib and his brother's family took refuge at the rooftop at his decent Don Ahmadi neighbor's house. The families of Bhutta Khan and Fazal Ahmadi went to an upstairs room in their own house and stayed there. In this time, the extremists entered the house and went to the room where 11 women and children had locked themselves. They tried to break down the door, and when they could not break it, they sealed the door so that it could not be opened from inside. They broke the glass of a window in the room. They gathered some plasticware and other things and set them on fire right underneath the window. The toxic smoke filled the room through the window and from under the door. These cruel and barbaric extremists, after setting the fire, gestured with their hands, and mockingly and tauntingly said goodbye to those in the room and left. There were 11 Ahmadis in it, including women and children. Due to the smoke inhalation, Bushra Begum and her two granddaughters, Hira and Gainat, were martyred. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Surely to Allah belong and to Him we shall return, due to choking. The mob was in such a frenzy that it did not allow the hospital ambulance and another emergency ambulance and also the fire brigade to come to the scene and forced them to turn away. They continued to burn all the houses and danced while the police stood by like silent spectators, doing nothing at all. They did not try to halt or apprehend the frenzied mob in any way, shape or form. The media also took considerable time to begin to start coverage of the incident, and the Punjab Chief Minister Shehbaz Sharif also took note of the incident after the extremists had completed their actions. Ahmadiyyat had come in the family of the martyred Bushra Begum Sahiba through her paternal grandfather, Mia Shahuddin Sahib. He was unable to accept Ahmadiyya during the era of the Second Khilafat and was blessed by joining the Jamaat. Although these people had gone to Sialkot, she was married in Gujranwala with Munir Ahmad Sahib and came there in 1976. Her husband passed away only 6 months ago. The other two martyrs, Hirat Tabassum and Ginat Tabassum, were her granddaughters. The martyred lady, with the grace of the Almighty Allah, was regular at offering her 5 daily prayers, also regularly after Tahajjud. She recited the Holy Quran regularly. She was extremely friendly, compassionate, loving and a hospitable person. She was very courteous and had very good morals, and feeding animals and birds was a daily routine. Despite the fact she did not hold any Jamaat office, but wherever and whenever he was required to serve the Jamaat, she was always present. At the time of her martyrdom, she had a gold ring on and also some earrings. She also had some cash on her, perhaps with the thought that they may have to leave the area. But as a result of choking, she passed away. When she was taken for a post-mortem, the oppressors even stole her jewelry. Only a day before her martyrdom, she had organized the iftari for her neighborhood. And the martyred granddaughter, Hira Tabassum, had gone to the neighbors with the food for the iftari to distribute. Muhammad Buddha Sahib, it is his mother and his two daughters who have been martyred. He lived in Saudi Arabia, but then there, due to the circumstances, he returned to Pakistan. There he began a car service station business. Allah the Almighty blessed him, it was quite a good business. His brother Fazal Ahmed Sahib also ran a generator hire business. It was a good business. This was also a cause of jealousy for the people in the area. Amir Sahib Gujarwala writes that the entire family is very sincere and very decent, and they hold great sense of honor for the Jamaat. This halqa in the area had been formed due to them, and they also made a salah center there. They were at the forefront of giving chanda and also responding to financial appeals. They always obeyed and cooperated with the Jamaat in every single way, and this was exemplary in them. The martyred lady leaves behind 3 sons and 2 daughters. One of the sons is here, Muhammad Bhutta Sahib, whose 2 daughters were martyred. In terms of the 2 young girls, they leave behind their mother and their father, a 5-year-old brother, Atal Wase, and a 3-year-old sister, Atal Noor. Amir Sahib Gujranwala writes further. On 27 July, on Sunday at 9:30, approximately 400 or 500 people attacked the Ahmadi homes of Jamaat Ahmadiyya Kachipam. The extremists associated some offensive photograph on Facebook to an Ahmadi youth, Akib Salim Sahib. And on this basis, they gathered the people and spread disorder, whereas this was completely groundless. The frenzied mob, apart from those who were martyred, they burned 6 other houses and looted their homes. There were also some Ahmadi businesses nearby, which they attacked. They looted the vending plant, the heavy generator, some metal girders, and also other possessions. In this incident of Gujranwala, apart from the martyred, the wife of Muhammad Bhutasai's brother, Fazal Ahmed's wife, Homera Sahiba, along with her daughter, Atiyatul Basir, 3 years old, who is a Waqfai No, Samar Munir Umar, who is 1 year old, and Talha Ansar, who is 1 month old. In addition, the sister of Muhammad Bhutasaheb, Mubashira Jari, wife of Jariullah Sahib of Sialkot, who had come to visit them. She was injured. Mubashira Sahiba was 7 months pregnant. She had come to visit her mother's home for Eid. When I mentioned that the baby had been lost, it was her child. She was sent to Rabwa for an operation. She is in very poor state. She is admitted at Tahir Hearts Institute in Rabwa. Due to smoke inhalation in her lungs, she has serious breathing problems. Other injured included 30-year-old Munib Lodi Sahib, who was hurt by the extremists. He has a broken jaw and lost 2 teeth, and his ear also is cut. And he's also been wounded on various parts of the body. He is currently under treatment. Khalil Ahmed Sahib was hurt due to being attacked by a bottle. When Muhammad Anwar Sahib of Sialkot came to know about the incident, he immediately came to help Humaira Fazal Ahmed Sahiba and Fazal Ahmed Sahib and the family. Because there were only a few people remaining when he arrived, the police then came. And through the police help, the ambulance was able to enter and help the victims. Even at the time when they were removing the people from inside, because there was fire burning, he also suffered some injuries. Bhutta Sahib's wife, Rukaya Begum, and her 2 children, Ataul Wase, aged 5 years old, and Siratul Umar, were also affected due to smoke inhalation, and they are both also not in good health. There are 18 Ahmadi homes which are together in this area, and they are all relatives. They are now in Rabwa. As I said, the attackers burnt down 6 homes completely, including all the possessions inside. There is the house of Ashraf Sahib, Bhutta Sahib, Salim Sahib, Khalil Sahib, and Firozdin Sahib. 2 houses were vandalized and looted, and only the possessions were removed and burnt. Master Bashir Sahib and Muzaffar Sahib's homes. In addition, 5 Ahmadi shops were looted completely and then burnt. Similarly, there was a local namaz center, a prayer center. It was attacked. They burned copies of the Holy Quran, Jamaat books and other possessions. And then the Salah center was burnt and thus martyred. So thus, this is the brief account of the oppression and cruelty by these people. Regarding them, Allah the Almighty says that if they do not repent, then the punishment of hell and the punishment of burning is decreed for them. May Allah the Almighty bring about chastisement to these leaders of the disbelievers, and also to those who are at the forefront of inciting others. God the Almighty certainly does elevate the status of the martyrs. But may He also grant steadfastness and patience to the relatives left behind, especially to those mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters who have been separated from their innocent girls and sisters. May Allah the Almighty also grant complete recovery to all those who are injured and wounded. And may He also make good their financial loss and grant them even more than before. after the Friday prayer, I will inshallah lead the funeral prayer.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyi'ati a'malina. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله